I'm John Kutsch. I run an engineering company called Whole World. We had a client that once asked us about thorium, and I became so interested in it. Me and some guys started an organization called Thorium Energy Alliance to promote the use of thorium. Initially, it was thorium as a nuclear fuel being used in a molten salt reactor, famous experiment that was done at Oak Ridge National Lab. Eventually, what we realized was there's equally as exciting things to do with thorium as a material. One of them, overlapping technology, is and use it as a fuel in an advanced molten salt, very high temperature reactor, you suddenly are getting into the range of being able to produce process heat, right? So you're at roughly the temperature of burning fuel.
So instead of burning fuel in the atmosphere, you're burning nuclear fuel, and that leads you to be able to do things like produce lots of hydrogen at very low cost. And that leads you to saying, well, what can I do with hydrogen? You know, I can make ammonia, I can make jet fuel, and one of the things that we're here to talk about is you can make really great steel.
This is to tell you how you would get to do that. The talk here is the bridge to 100% true DRI, for real DRI, and DRI is, right, the direct reduction of iron in the presence of lots and lots of hydrogen. You do it in three steps. You're going from hematite to magnetite, magnetite to ferrous oxide, and then ferrous oxide to their other products. But we have a situation where we could actually start with magnetite, so that saves a tremendous amount of the hydrogen that you actually need to do this. Somebody else that's doing this is here at the conference. You should take some note of. Maybe go look into it, the SSAB hybrid steel process. I give them a lot of props for trying to be the first and doing their first batch the other day. The only thing that I wish I knew more about, and they do need pelletized iron. Here they're saying it's pelletized, that doesn't take that much energy, but we all know that's a huge amount of energy. What if you used a system that wasn't a shaft furnace? What if you could use different systems there that didn't need the pelletizing? The lower left-hand corner is what people consider DRI today. They're starting out with natural gas. They're using a lot of carbon monoxide. You know, the amount of actual hydrogen is very, very small. So it's not really true DRI, not 100% DRI, not the dream. I'm a big fan of Buckminster Fuller, big talker, but he really did strike upon some interesting things once in a while. And back in the 60s, 50s, NASA and the Air Administration before that, you know, said, hey, you know, how do we get to the moon? And he and a group of guys basically said, here's all the things you would need to get to the moon. You know, you'd need life support, really big rockets, you know, certain kinds of metallurgy. And so this is, what do you need to get to the moon of pure 100% hydrogen? The thought experiment would go something like this. You know, Houston already has a big Midrex plant, right? So we'll just pick Houston. They picked Houston. Why do you pick Houston or somewhere in Texas, somewhere in the ERCOT subgrid? There's tremendous amounts of curtailed energy and excess energy supply down there. Maybe not this winter. They didn't have a lot. In general, they have a lot. The other part is politically, they're enthusiastic about projects like this. They are their own grid, their own subgrid, so they can make decisions. They're nuclear friendly, access to chemical industries, good thought experiment places to where you would do something like this. Is when you get to something in the area of 3 cents a kilowatt electricity or less, even today, even with the technology today, and it's just today basically, that's the point of this talk, we have just literally got that last pillar of the bridge in place. We can actually start making hydrogen for cheaper than Gulf Coast hydrogen. A giant battery, right? You need a huge battery because curtailed power comes and goes. This is why it's intermittent, right? The sun comes out all of a sudden, 500 megawatts hit the grid. They don't know what to do with it. Today, they literally burn it off. So what if you gave them a way to take on hundreds and hundreds of megawatts of power? Conversely, middle of the night, your merchant class generator, like a nuclear power plant, is capable of producing thousands of really reliable megawatts, but it's not. It's dialed way back because there's no one there to pay for it. So nuclear is always kicked to the back of the bus, right? Cost of electricity is the highest. Nuclear gets shoved to the back of the line, and wind and solar get to have that super expensive power first. Nuclear is left being the reliable handmaid that is always making 24/7 reliable electricity. My particular battery of choice is a giant thermal storage system. You know, Bill Gates and his minions have chosen that too. They have a natrium system that they're building with General Electric. Natrium is a big sodium fast reactor. coupled to a giant bucket of salt. And so when you get salt to 700-800 degrees Celsius and you store a couple million pounds of it, you can store thousands of megawatt hours. That's the scale you need, not tens of megawatt hours or hundreds of megawatt hours. But if you're going to do something like this, something big, like a big integrated steel facility, you need access to thousands of megawatt hours per hour, 24 hours a day. By the way, you'll notice I'm not really talking about the green aspect of the green steel so much. We're not doing this because it's green. We're not doing it because it's decarbonizing. We're doing it because this is the most economic way to make steel. Not in the future, but right now, if you could integrate it and do these steps that I'm talking about, this would be the best, cheapest way to make steel. So this is my personal favorite way to store thousands of megawatt hours. There's other ways, pumped hydro being probably the most proven because it's been around for well over a century. So then another pillar of the bridge is high temperature steam electrolysis. So we all know electrolysis from grade school, you stick the two probes in the glass of water, hydrogen comes off one, oxygen comes off the other. Now instead of just using 100% electricity, if my dream comes true, a very hot reactor, and so instead of 100% electricity to make the hydrogen, take about 80% of your power in the form of heat, get the water supercritical to 600-700 degrees Celsius, and then it just takes a little bit of electricity to knock it over the edge and split it into hydrogen. So you're about 30 to 60% more efficient using these high temperature steam electrolysis systems, the price of which have finally reached that hockey stick of 7% decrease in cost each year, 10% increase in quality. All these things used to be hand-built. It was like buying a Rolls-Royce Silver Ghost, you know, some guy hand-making every little part. Now they finally have enough investment, the chicken and the egg thing, where they've automated processes, automation brings quality, the quality's gone up, the costs have gone down. So that pillar is in place. The third pillar, if you ask me, is one that people don't think about when they're talking about hydrogen production through electrolysis, and that's water. You need a lot of water. So another reason you want to put it in Houston, they got a lot of water, probably more water than they ever wish they had, but it's salt water, so you need to desalinate it. But even fresh water, no matter what water you start with, if you're going to run an electrolysis system, it needs to be essentially deionized water. It needs to be like lab-grade water. Otherwise, you're going to ruin your stack. Very, very pure water comes at a very big price, but we've got 50 years of really excellent reverse osmosis systems, and the cost is coming down at that same hockey stick rate, and it's something we desperately need in the world, right? There's 50,000 reverse osmosis plants in the world. Blows my mind, who knew? But they're all different sizes, but we need the economy of scale that comes when you start making that many reverse osmosis units and replaceable cartridges. The cost has come down, the quality's gone up. A near-term innovation in that is resin bed reverse osmosis systems basically have a molecular sieve. You would still need to do some final work to it, but the molecular sieve cleaning of the water could reduce the cost of getting from salt water to fresh water standard by 90%. And, if you want to catch me afterwards, there's some really interesting uses for brine. The one pillar in my book that isn't complete yet, although there's companies and, of course, China doing a lot of work developing these molten salt reactors. There's companies like Copenhagen Atomics that is doing an excellent job of developing all the components and all the subsystems and the salt fabrication. All this stuff had to be reinvented from the 1950s and 60s when we actually had a working molten salt reactor. I'm not a monster. I'm not going to read the slides to you. But you can see these 9 bullet points are just the start. You could see why this is so attractive. One thing that I'll leave you with is when you are inherently safe, you don't need quadruple redundant safety systems, right? And what drives the cost of nuclear are the safety systems. The nuclear island itself doesn't cost anything. It's all the ancillary things around it. So if you can make a safety case to the NRC that you don't need these redundant safety systems because it is inherently safe, it physically can't do the things that like a light water reactor can do. The inherent safety drives the cost down. The fact that these things aren't very big lets them be factory made, and you get access to that same sort of virtuous cycle of you make them in a factory, you get good at making them, the quality goes up, the cost goes down, if we can start making lots of thermal storage systems that are basically molten salt nuclear reactors without uranium or moderators, by making these thermal storage systems, we learn how to take on lots of energy, give out lots of energy, handle salts, pump salts, learn about materials and insulation and fabricating big buckets. When the time comes, when the NRC gives us a license, we're able to add in the nuclear component. Some of the bottlenecks, by the way, that people don't often talk about, we spoke about it a little bit earlier, is like, I don't like pellets, you know, where they come from. You don't get that for free. That's a big economic cost, big energy cost. The group that I'm working with, instead of doing pellets, you deal with the fines. You know, you put some binder in the fines. This is the Mezzo Ototech system that was proven in Trinidad. It was debugged in Trinidad. It ran for years. It was extraneous political and economic forces that had nothing to do with the process itself. And it was 100% H2 DRI. It's just that they got their H2 from natural gas. I have a great faith that the Mezzo Circle Red system is the way to do DRI. You don't have the whole pelletizing front end. At the back end, you got HBI that you can feed right into an electric arc furnace. Two other things, our system would make an excess couple million tons of oxygen each year. So if you got ideas about what to do with lots of oxygen, I'm all ears. Just another like weird thing that came up the other day. Somebody complained that you're not really carbon neutral, John, because the electrodes in the EAF use a lot of carbon. And you're like, gah, yeah, I guess it does. But, you know, how do you make carbon-free carbon electrodes? I don't know. Maybe you can make carbon neutral electrodes. You know, like I said, I'm not a monster. I won't read all these bullet points to you. But this isn't from me. This is from the Idaho National Lab. It had done tremendous amounts of techno-economic analysis. Basically, what it comes down to is, this is economic on its own, but when you add in the icing of carbon credits, let alone a few subsidies, which I'm sure SSAB are taking full advantage of, you don't need that. You don't need that. This would be very economic steel to make. Using 14-year-old high-temperature steam electrolysis system, 14-year-old efficiencies and 14-year-old costs, we were seeing in the range of $1 a kilogram hydrogen. $1 hydrogen is the cheapest hydrogen that's ever been produced in the Gulf. That's the magic number. I'm not talking about being green. I'm not talking about avoiding carbon. I'm talking about if you want to make money, this is the way to do it. Because if this is the cheapest way to make hydrogen, cheaper than natural gas, that is what the accountants, that's what the bean counters are going to want to use. That's what's going to make them the money. What else is going to make you money? You know, I show this graph to some people and I'm like, well, this is your cost curve for making hydrogen from natural gas. You know, it's here, it's up here, and it just slides up and down that curve. And they're like, well, where's the nuclear? And I'm like, it's all these flat lines. They're like, why is it flat? It's flat because nuclear makes power for the same price every day, day in, day out, for the next 40, 50, 80 years. Not just flat, but probably declining, because you're going to learn, and every time you replace a system or upgrade it, it's going to get better and better. That eliminates beta. The variability in pricing of your commodity is one of the hardest things to manage in a steel facility. If you get rid of the variability of your fuel, your energy inputs, how much in your organization does that save? Millions? Hundreds of millions? I bet it does. And the elimination of beta is a huge, huge, powerful reason to go to a nuclear system. Here's my little announcement that right now the bridge is being built. So just the way that SSAB with their hybrid system is using a hydroelectric dam, there's a new future with, we have a pure green steel system coming on. It uses excess light water reactor nuclear capacity. It takes on board curtailed renewable energy and puts it into, we have a pumped hydro system integrated into the mine. So the mine itself is a magnetite mine. The Pea Ridge mine in Missouri, it was an operating mine, a proven mine for 40 years, going to be reopened, and it's going to have this first new integrated steel facility in decades. The magic there is this pumped hydro is the giant battery that allows us to take in these curtailed sources, these excess sources to run the hydrogen making and the DRI, all the ancillary equipment. And you can see you don't get any of these products. You get steel and oxygen. Those are your only two products. Super exciting. It's going to happen here in the United States. It's going to be bigger, greener, truly carbon free from below ground mine all the way to metal. I would put this up against the SSAB project, open up the kimono and say, this is carbon free from start to finish. We're not just the ones thinking about doing it. The Swedes aren't just the ones doing it. This is from Synap. This is the Chinese organization. And from the beginning, this is what they've wanted to build their molten salt reactor for. They're not talking about it. It's not a paper reactor. That's it. That's a year and a half old picture. You can be pretty sure that they're a lot further along now. They're very close to starting up their first molten salt reactor. This is their integrated facility. The reactor, hydrogen, bringing on board concentrated solar and photovoltaic. And what are they going to do with it? They've said right from the beginning, since 2011, we're going to make steel with it. We're going to make liquid fuels. If you don't believe me, if you don't believe the Swedes, the Chinese are big into this. You don't do it to be green. This is the way steel is going to be made in the future. And I would really strongly suggest you get on board with it. We can have a future of prosperity and abundance. And we can get all those other green benefits.